Hi, and thanks for joining this session. I'm Jim Godin, the founder of Hoskins, Adventures in the Circular Economy. Today, in this short 20-minute session, I'm going to be talking you through measuring circularity and circularity-related impacts. Now, this captures around 10 years of work for me as a circular economy lead, working with the Ellen MacArthur Foundation on the development of the Material Circularity Indicator, or MCI. And I hope you'll find the session useful and enlightening. You can see my email address on the screen now, and it'll be back on screen at the end of the session in case you want to reach out. I'm more than happy to answer your questions and to explore how Hoskins can support you to measure the circularity of your business and products. In the session today, I'll start with an introduction to what the circular economy is, and then move on to reflect on what we mean by circularity. I'll outline why it's a good idea to measure circularity, and then go into the Material Circularity Indicator, discussing where it came from, what it does, and what data you'll need to be able to use it. Don't worry though, I'm not going to go deep into the maths behind the approach, but will instead illustrate in a very simple example how the MCI can be applied to quantify the circularity of a product very quickly and easily to capture the value that is often lost by the outdated linear system we have today. At the end, I'll show you where to find more information, including a calculator for the Material Circularity Indicator that I'm using in this session, and we'll be uploading for you to our website in the coming weeks. So without further ado, let's get started. So first of all, if we look at the need for the circular economy, we can look at the long-term decreases in consumer prices over the past 100 years. This steady decline has been essentially wiped out over the past 20 years, as illustrated by the chart from McKinsey. Now this chart only actually extends to 2013, and there has been some downward movement since then, but not enough to undo this trend overall. And it is as yet unclear what effect COVID-19 will have on this trend, as supply chains and markets have been disrupted. Part of this increase in material costs is as a result of increasing demand for materials and a growing global middle class. On the left, we can see the OECD predictions for the increase in the middle classes between 2009 and 2030. And on the right, we can see how more developed countries tend to have a higher level of consumption of materials. It is not just down to this, however, because on top of this, we have seen generally decreasing ore grades globally, meaning that it takes progressively more energy to extract the same amount of material from a ton of ore. It's also the case that our economy is currently very linear. Across every sector, we're blessed with amazing materials. In some cases, these have taken billions of dollars to develop. But once we finish with the product, it typically gets disposed of. In some cases, this is a product design failure or a system model failure. In many others, fast fashion, for example, is also a failure in how we behave and how we see products as disposable. This also doesn't just apply to mined materials. We're also hugely wasteful when it comes to food, and much of our biological resource extraction isn't regenerative. The circular economy is a model that seeks to resolve this, not from the perspective of the environment, although that is a byproduct when it's well implemented. As the name suggests, the primary focus is to capture and capitalise upon the lost value in the current system by decoupling the economy from linear resource extraction. The way it does this is by keeping valuable materials in circulation at their highest value for as long as possible. This isn't just about recycling, however, as recycling only captures the material value of the product. If we take an iPhone 6, for example, the resale value of that today is around £130, second hand. The value of the raw materials it contains, though, is only about £2 of that. The other £128 is value that has been added by assembling the materials into components and the product itself, along with non-physical value associated with the software, branding, and associated services that go with the product. The circular economy then prioritises the inner loops of durability, reuse, remanufacturing, over the lower value loops of recycling. Coupled to the model is a focus on the separation of biological and technical material flows to avoid contamination, also the shift towards renewable energy sources and the adoption of alternative systems models, such as leasing of products and products as a service model. Overall, the opportunity from adopting this approach has been estimated by McKinsey to be €1.8 trillion for the EU alone by 2030. So when we talk about circularity, what do we actually mean? Here we need to differentiate between the circular economy system and circularity. The circular economy system is what we're actually trying to deliver. This includes all of the benefits of the circular economy, including the economic benefits, both direct economic benefits in terms of savings in material procurement and manufacturing costs, but also less direct costs associated with risk avoidance. Mitigations, for example, against future price increases, supply chain disruptions as we've seen recently, and competition for resources. Also, avoidance of future regulatory issues that might force a shift to circular models, as well as avoiding the risk that a new market entrant with circularity at their core will disrupt your existing hard-earned market. The environmental benefits, of course, including energy, CO2 and waste, for example, and the social benefits, such as job creation, and the ability to source any residual virgin materials according to fair trade principles. Circularity, on the other hand, relates to the flow of materials within the circular economy model. It's how we deliver the benefits we're looking for in our circular economy system, and it's also a measure of how effectively we've decoupled our growth from the outdated linear consumption model. So why do we need to measure circularity as its own metric? The first reason to quantify circularity is that you can't improve what you don't measure. We want to be able to apply circularity to the design of our products, to benchmark our circular products against linear alternatives or those of our competitors, to evaluate whether we're on track to deliver the circular economy benefits we originally designed into our systems. And we also want to be able to use circularity as a marketing tool, to be able to sell our product or services to our customer more effectively and to seize market share. The second reason is that we want to be able to optimize the benefits we realize from circularity. Making something more circular doesn't always mean making it cheaper, lower carbon, or more socially equitable, although it should. For every product, there are trade-offs to be made to deliver an effective circular economy model, and this may need to be adjusted during the lifetime of the product to remain effective. Looking at where the Material Circularity Indicator, or MCI, came from, this was a project that was started back in 2013. The first version of the methodology was published in 2015, and we updated the methodology last year through the inclusion of biological material flows within the methodology. Now, the participants across both the first and second version of the methodology were a wide range of investors, universities, government bodies, standards bodies, regulators, businesses and NGOs. I'm not going to go into the full details of the methodology and I don't intend to go into the calculations behind it. If you do want to access a copy of the methodology, there is a link on the screen that will take you through to my website, which has a link to the most recent version of the methodology on the Ellen MacArthur Foundation website. Building off the circular economy butterfly diagram we saw earlier, it's clear that there are multiple levers to circularity, or things that you can change to make a product or system more circular. We can obviously design out the need for materials in the first place, for example by removing the need for the product, by replacing it with a service, for example. We can also use regeneratively produced biological materials in place of technical materials, the so-called circular bioeconomy, which was represented on the left-hand side of the butterfly diagram in my previous slide. We can design our products to last longer so they don't need to be replaced by new products so frequently. This includes not just physical durability but also emotional durability, as many products are not replaced because of a loss of function but because we tire of them and want the latest version. We can use products more heavily, perhaps through a sharing model, which again reduces the total number of products needed by the market. We can design our products to be reused so we don't need to produce the same thing the next time we need it. Or we can remanufacture or refurbish a product into an as-new condition, putting only a bare minimum of new materials in. We can obviously recycle the material to reduce the need for new material extraction, although this tends only to recover the material value and not the added manufacturing value. It also tends to be inefficient and can lead to a loss of material properties. For biological materials, we can of course compost these to return the biological nutrients to the environment to produce new materials, although this does mean that we would need to ensure the material isn't contaminated with chemicals that would be detrimental to the environment. And in some very isolated cases, for regeneratively sourced biological material specifically, we can also use energy recovery, recapturing the CO2 and nutrients this way if there is no other viable alternative. The challenge we faced with the circular economy was that each of these levers could be considered a metric in its own right. What we wanted was a number that reflected all of these levers acting in combination, which would give us an overall reflection of how circular a system was. We also wanted this metric to apply to complex products and also to be operable at the company level, reflecting many different products in a portfolio. And this is what we achieved through the MCI, through a metric that essentially ranges from 0.1 for an entirely linear system to 1.0 for an entirely circular system. And I'll go through and give you some examples of how that actually works in practice. Although again, I won't go into the details of the calculation because we don't really have time on this presentation. Now, there are many other methodologies out there for quantifying circularity, but the majority of them are highly qualitative. This approach with the Material Circularity Indicator has the advantage of being quantitative, and this is really what we need if we were to be able to compare products effectively, or perhaps in the future to have some form of certification scheme. So what data do you actually need to have to be able to use this methodology? The way I like to visualise this is as a set of material inputs, a set of material outputs, and a couple of indicators in the middle which reflect how the product is used. On the input side, you obviously need to have the mass of the materials, the percentage of those that are from reuse, from remanufacturing, or from recycled sources. You also need to know if they have any biological materials, what percentage of the product they make up, and how much of those are sourced from a supply that could be considered regenerative. On the material output side, it's all about where the materials are going. So how much of those products are recovered from use through reuse, remanufacturing, recycling, composting, energy recovery, or landfill. When it comes to recycling, we also need to know the efficiency of the recycling process. In the middle, we have the product use, and here we can base it either on lifetime versus a reference, or utility versus a reference. So how long the product lasts, or how heavily the product is used during its lifetime. So let's have a look at a really simple example using a calculator we've put together at Hoskins to apply the Material Circularity Indicator quickly and easily to simple products. If you would like to use this calculator afterwards, I do plan to put a copy on my website at some point over the next few weeks, so please keep an eye out for that. The example we'll use here is a simple pen. So we have the tube for the pen, the ink tube inside that, the metal nib to actually do the writing, and a lid, which in this case we've already lost. We specified some very generic materials for the pen. These are all virgin materials in this case, and we're assuming that they all end up in landfill, so the pen's going to be thrown out at the end of its life. We're also assuming that our pen lasts for 2 years until it's thrown out, and that this is generally the case for pens of this type. The pen is very linear in this case, and has an MCI of 0.1, which indicates linear. So if we have a look at the economics first, this is what we're actually trying to deliver through our circular economy model. We can see the price ranges for the different components of the pen here on the screen. Now, there are ranges because we've not specified specific grades. So what we're looking at here is a range of material costs, considering every type of polymer and every type of metal we could use. Now, this does, of course, highlight that we could potentially bring the material costs down by selecting a different grade. But let's put that to one side for this case study. Looking at which component is likely to be the most expensive, we're probably more concerned about the pen tube than the ink tube and metal nib. So let's see what we can do about these by applying a circular model with a focus on recapturing that value. Here we've updated our model to use a recycled grade for the tubes and nib, and we're going to recycle these back into our product again. We're assuming we can collect 50% of the pens that we put out onto the market, but we're not going to collect the lids as these all tend to get lost anyway. The circularity is now improved and we're now at 0.2 overall, with the metal nib being slightly more circular because of the generally higher recycled content in metals. What if we're now concerned about all of those lids that are going missing, and what these might do to our reputation if they end up in the oceans or littering the streets? We'll update our calculation again, and this time we're going to use a home compostable bioplastic, and we're going to source the feedstock for this from a regeneratively managed forest. This has increased the circularity of the lid to 0.6 now, and this has also increased our overall circularity to 0.3 for the whole pen. Perhaps if we make the pen last a bit longer, we can improve this. So now we've taken things a bit further and we've made the pen a bit more reliable, or otherwise perhaps through a business model, we've increased the lifetime of the pen to 3 years, putting it above the typical pen lifetime of 2 years. Doing this on top of the other measures we've applied increases the overall circularity to just over 0.5. It has also improved the circularity of each of the components. Perhaps we can take things further still and have a model to refill and reuse these pens. To reflect this, we've changed the destination of the output materials to reuse for the pen tube, the ink tube, and the metal nib. We have, however, kept the source of the materials as being recycled grades because this is the life cycle of the first use of the product. Doing this on top of our other measures would bring our circularity closer to 0.6 for this life cycle of the product. For the second life cycle onwards, though, we would be using more reused pens already, and our circularity would be closer to 0.8 as a result. Although in this model we've not accounted for the more complex issues of mixed reuse and recycled material needed to adjust for lost pens, because we're only recovering 50% of our pens from the market. This particular model that we put together here is deliberately simplistic, but those sort of inclusions can be easily accommodated. This last point does, however, highlight something important about metrics for the circular economy. When implementing these, we need to start thinking for all of our complementary metrics beyond the impact of the single life cycle. Circularity, after all, isn't a constant to be defined by what happens initially, but it evolves instead from one life cycle to the next. Likewise, the costs and impacts associated with the model change as the circular business model is implemented and as products age and are reused or recycled or deteriorate. For example, to make our pen more durable, in our example, we may need to use a more expensive material initially, or one with a higher environmental impact. This impact would, we hope, be offset by the lower need for new materials in the second and subsequent uses of the pen as an avoided burden, making the cost and impact per use lower than our first disposable pen. There is therefore a place for MCI to be used not just for designing circular products, but also as a monitoring tool to track how our circular model is actually performing, and to verify that we've not only designed something circular, but that our implementation of our business model, our engagement with the product user, and all of the surrounding infrastructures and public policies needed are working to support us to actually deliver the value we seek from the circular economy. This brings me to the end of my brief presentation for today, but I wanted to provide you with some links in case you want to contact me or to read more about the methodology. The QR code on the left-hand side of the screen now will take you through to our website. So if you're generally interested in what we do, or would like to see how we can help you to get started with using the material circularity indicators, please do reach out through the website or through my email at the bottom. It's also where we'll post the simple tool that I've walked you through today, where we've implemented the methodology that will allow you to use this in a very general way to understand how material circularity indicators will work for you and how they could apply to your product. The QR code on the right hand side will take you through to our useful links page that links out to the current version of the methodology on the Ellen MacArthur Foundation website. So if you want to dig into the detail and understand the calculations involved, please use this link or visit our website to find that link to the methodology. As I said, you can also see my email address there at the bottom, and you can also find me on networks such as LinkedIn. So please do feel free to reach out to connect, as it's always good to speak to other people who are working in this field. Thank you for your time today. I hope you're all doing well, and take care.